How to Postpone Your Funeral. Great to see everyone here. We're looking forward to our presentation. How to Postpone Your what? Funeral. Interesting title, isn't it? And I'm looking forward to this presentation. I trust that it's going to be a great blessing to you. We're going to discover today that God is bigger than many people think. God is bigger than many people think. Many people have this idea of God, this conception of God, that He is concerned only with spiritual, so-called spiritual realities. What we're going to discover today is that God has made man as a multifaceted being. And He's not just concerned with our spiritual welfare, He's also concerned with our physical welfare and our emotional welfare and our social welfare as well. And so we're going to discover today that man is multifaceted, that he is very, very broad in his makeup, that is to say his physical makeup, his mental makeup, his emotional makeup. We're going to see that God is big and God is awesome. And so how to postpone your funeral, but before we get into the presentation, what are we going to do first? That's right, let's pray together as we commence. Father in heaven today, we come to you knowing that death is the enemy. You've told us that. Death is the enemy and that at long last death will be swallowed up in victory. But Father, even while we live in the here and now, we have to face this great reality and this great eventuality that comes to everyone. That is the question of death. And Father, yet many people are dying prematurely. Many people are dying before their time, as Solomon says in Ecclesiastes. Father, today we want to know how to postpone our funeral. That is how to live happy, healthy lives in the here and now. Please, Father, bless us now as we open your word. May you open our hearts. We ask it in Jesus' name. Let everyone say, amen and amen. Let's begin by looking at the book of Revelation. Let's go to Revelation chapter 14. Now, this is a passage that we've looked at before, Revelation chapter 14. But what I'd like to do is take a look at this from a slightly different perspective than many of us may be accustomed to. We're in Revelation chapter 14. Now, in Revelation chapter 14, we find three angels with urgent, critical, end-time messages. Three angels with critical messages, and this is sometimes referred to as the three angels' messages. And you know these messages are important. You know these messages are significant and urgent because the very next thing that happens after the occurrence of the three angels' messages, the very next thing that happens after the three angels give their messages is the second coming of Jesus. In fact, one way to look at it is this. These three messages result in the second coming of Jesus. These three messages bring about the second coming of Jesus. That's how important they are. That's how critical they are. That's how significant and central they are. So we're in Revelation chapter 14, beginning in verse 6, for the first of these three angels' messages. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 6. John there on the island of Patmos, 24 miles out into the Aegean Sea. It was a penal colony. It had been put there by the Roman authorities because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. Jesus, the resurrected Christ, appears to him and gives him these many glorious, wonderful, almost cinematic visions. And so we pick it up here with John in Revelation chapter 14 and verse 6. John says, "Then I saw another what? Angel." The word angel simply means messenger. Sometimes we get this idea that an angel is, you know, this being clothed in white with wings, etc., etc. And while there may be some biblical truth to that, the reality is that an angel is simply a messenger. A what, everyone? A messenger. Think of this. Have you ever heard of the term evangelist? Evangelist? Sure you have. Now, if you take the EV off the front and the IST off the back, what word do you have in the middle? That's exactly right. You have the word angel. In other words, an evangelist is a carrier or a bearer of a message. Of a message. And so John says there in Revelation chapter 14 verse 6, "Then I saw another angel," that is another messenger, "flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people." So the first thing we learn about this angel is he has the everlasting gospel. Everything has to begin with the gospel if you believe that. Say amen. Amen. But notice it says here that this message that he has that's communicated in the context of the gospel is for the whole world. It's not just for an isolated people group here. It's not just for an isolated people group here. God doesn't play favorites. God is no respecter of persons. He shows no partiality. It says that every nation, every tribe, and every tongue and people need to hear this urgent, significant end time message. Verse 7, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment has come, and worship Him who made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and the springs of waters." Now, this is the first of the three angels' messages, and I want you to notice that the very first part of what the angel actually says is, "Fear God." Now, many people have a radical misunderstanding of what that means, a total misunderstanding of what it means to fear God. When we say fear God, it doesn't mean to be afraid of God in the way you might be afraid of something terrible happening. Fearing God means to reverence God, to stand in awe of God. To put it very, very simply, to fear God is to understand who God is and who you are in relationship to God. God is the infinite, omnipotent, omnibenevolent, eternal God of the universe, the eternal being of the universe, and you're dust. You're dust. And so when we fear God, it's understanding who God is, who we are, and our relationship to God. We have a reverential awe for God, not a, I'm so afraid of God. No, a reverential awe and respect and reverence for God. So fear God, and notice this next part, and give glory to Him. Fear God and give what to Him, everyone? Glory. Now, what does that mean? That's religious language. What does it mean to give glory to God? This is what it means. It means to live your life for God. To live what, everyone? To live your life for God. Not just in the so-called big areas, but even in the small areas. What it means is to live your life with God in mind. To live your life with excellence, not for your own glory, not for your own upbuilding, not for your own personal satisfaction and accomplishments, but to live your life to the glory of God. Fear God, says the angel, and give glory to Him. Well, that would raise an interesting question. Does God want us to glorify Him in all aspects of our life? What do you think the answer to that question is? I think the answer is exactly yes. In fact, go with me from the book of Revelation. We've seen the end time urgent significance of these messages. Go with me to the book of 1 Corinthians, and we'll discover here one way that we can glorify God. And you're probably going to be a little bit surprised here. We're going to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians, I'm in chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and I'm in verse 31. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, it says, "Therefore, whether you eat or what? Drink," that's right, "whatever you do, do all to the what?" That's right, to the glory of God. Isn't this fascinating? Paul here says, "Therefore, whether you eat or whether you drink, do all to the glory of God." We just saw one of those urgent end time three angels messages there. Fear God and give glory to Him. And here Paul says, even in your eating, even in your drinking, give glory to God. Now that raises an interesting question, doesn't it? I mean, according to this verse, can you eat in a way that glorifies God? The answer would be yes, wouldn't it? And according to this verse, can you drink in a way that brings glory to God? Well, the answer to that would be yes as well. But wait a minute. If we can eat in a way that is to the glory of God, and if we can eat, drink in a way that is to the glory of God, it must mean then that by the process of deduction, we must also be able to eat in a way that does not glorify God, and it must be possible to drink in a way that does not glorify God. Does that make sense, everyone? Yes or no? If it's possible to eat to His glory and to drink to His glory, then it must also be possible to eat in a way or drink in a way that is not to His glory. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. So we're in 1 Corinthians, now I'm looking at chapter 6. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and notice with me verse 19. "Or do you not know that your body," your what, everyone? "Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own. For you were bought with a price, therefore," here it is again, "glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's." Sometimes we think of God as being only interested in spiritual things. Sometimes we think of God as only interested in Bible study and prayer and the so-called spiritual aspects, religious aspects of life. Not at all. It says here, glorify God in your body. In your what, everyone? In your body. And I'm going to 1 Corinthians chapter 3 as well. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And I'm reading in verse 16. He says, "Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are." Here in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and chapter 3, we find the Apostle Paul communicating to us, obviously under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that God is concerned about what happens to our body. We should be taking care of this body, eating and drinking and living in a way in our body that brings glory to God. And I want to say it again because it's so critical. Many times we don't think about God as being interested in these sort of day-to-day things. I mean, you know, we go to the restaurant and you know, we order whatever it is there on the menu, or we go to the grocery store and we buy whatever's there. And are we really thinking, I want to buy something that will help me to glorify God? I mean, really, be honest. Is that the kind of thing that we're thinking? More often than not, no. But what Paul is saying, when you eat, think about God's glory. When you drink, think about God's glory. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. He says, glorify God in your body. That's exactly right. And as we've already said in our prayer, man is multidimensional. Man is what, everyone? Multidimensional. In fact, look at this in the little book of 3 John, right there toward the end of the New Testament, 3 John chapter 1, there's only one chapter in that book. It says, "Beloved," verse 2, "I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in," what is that word right there? "Health, just as your soul prospers." Now, when he speaks of health here, you must know that he's talking about more than just spiritual health, because he says he wants us to be in health just as our soul prospers. John is assuming that the soul is healthy. John is assuming that your spiritual life is healthy. And then he says, "I want you also to be physically healthy." That's clearly implied by the context. "To be physically healthy in your body." Wow, that agrees perfectly with what we saw there in Paul's writings, that the body is a place we need to glorify God. And John here says you need to be healthy, not just mentally, not just spiritually, not just religiously. You need to be healthy physically as well. Now, open your Bibles with me to Luke. Matthew, Mark, Luke, third book of the New Testament, Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, Matthew, Mark, Luke chapter 2, and notice with me the last verse of that chapter. Luke chapter 2, verse 52. Luke chapter 2, verse 52. It says here, very interesting verse. It says, "And Jesus," and who, everyone? "Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men." Now, it's very interesting here. This is describing Jesus' growth. Jesus what? Growth. And notice it says he increased in four essential areas. I'll read it again. Jesus increased in wisdom. That would be intellectual growth. Jesus increased also in stature. That would be physical growth. He increased in favor with God. That would be spiritual growth. And in favor with men, that would be social growth. And so here we have this multidimensionality of man. He is not just a physical being, as the materialist would say, as the naturalist would say, as the evolutionist would say. Man is more than material. But man is also more than spiritual. Sometimes as religionists, we can go too far the opposite direction. We say, "Oh, God's concerned about my prayer life, and God's concerned about my Bible study time, and God's concerned about my witnessing." But God's not concerned about what you eat. God's not concerned about what you buy at the grocery store. God's not concerned about what you put into this body that was purchased by the blood of Jesus. No, 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 no. Notice it here. Man is intellectual. Man is physical. Man is social. Man is spiritual. Here we see the four-dimensional nature of man. And I want to ask you a very simple question. Is God concerned about our intellectual growth? Yes or no? Of course he would be. Is God concerned about our physical growth? Of course he would be, as we've already seen. Eat and drink to the glory of God. Is God concerned about our social growth? Of course he would be. And spiritual goes without saying. Now, what we're going to see today is that we can actually postpone our funeral by living according to God's plan for optimum intellectual, physical, social, and spiritual health. I want to say that again. We can actually postpone our funeral by living according to God's plan for maximum intellectual, physical, social, and spiritual growth. Very interesting. Now, someone's going to say, "Well, what do you mean postpone your funeral? We all have our time, and you know, my time might be this day and your time might be that day." Beloved, 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 the wisest man that ever lived, a man by the name of Solomon in the book of Ecclesiastes, I believe it's chapter 7, might be verse 17, somewhere around there. Solomon says that you can die before your time. You can die before your time. In other words, this idea that, well, we're all going to die sometime, and so I'll just smoke. No, 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 no. Beloved, you can die before the time that God wants you to die, before the time that He has allotted you to die. I mean, really, if you're going to take that to its logical conclusion, you say, well, we all have our time. We're all going to go sometime. Then why don't you get your car up to 90 miles an hour, set the cruise control, and jump out? Beloved, this idea that we all have a set time that God has appointed us to die, the reality is that God wants us to live happy, healthy, satisfying, wholesome lives, intellectual lives, physical lives, social lives, and spiritual lives. And while it is true that we're not going to live forever, at least not in this body, at least not here on planet Earth, how foolish is it of us to unnecessarily shorten or cut short the amount of time that God intends for us to live to His glory? And so we conclude so far what we've learned. Revelation chapter 14, there's an urgent message to glorify God. If that makes sense, say amen. Amen. First Corinthians chapter 10, we've seen that God wants to be glorified in our bodies. In our what, everyone? In our bodies, and that we can eat to His glory and we can drink to His glory. And as we've already said, it stands to reason. If there's a way that we can eat that is to God's glory, if there's a way that we can drink that is to God's glory, it must also be true then that there's a way that we could eat or drink that would what? Not be to God's glory. And then we go to Luke chapter 2, verse 52. We find that Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. And so we see here the fourfold dimensionality of man. He's a physical being, he's an intellectual being, he's a spiritual being, and a social being. If what we've covered so far makes sense, I want you to say amen. All right, we're all together. Now let's continue on here. God communicates with us through the brain. Through the what, everyone? Through the brain. You might prefer me to say that God communicates with us through the mind. That's fine. The mind, the seat of the mind, is the brain. Okay? Think of it this way. If you were involved in a terrible accident, say a terrible industrial accident or perhaps a car accident, and your right hand had to be amputated, your whole right arm, rather, had to be amputated, let me ask you this question. Could you still have a meaningful relationship with God without a right arm, yes or no? Absolutely you could. And then let's imagine that you were involved in another terrible accident and your left arm had to be amputated. So all you had was legs and a trunk and a neck and a head. Could you have a meaningful relationship with God like this with no arms? Yes or no? Sure, of course you could, because you still have desires and you still have ambitions and you still have goals and you still have love, and of course you could have a meaningful relationship with God. But what if then you lost your legs? Right? I can't do that. I'm not able to do that physically. But if your legs were gone as well, so that all you were was a trunk and a neck and a head, could you still have a relationship with God if your mind was intact? Of course you could. The answer is yes. And here's why. Because God does not communicate with you through your fingers, through your elbow, through your knees, or through your legs. God communicates with you through your mind. Through your what, everyone? Through your mind. That's exactly right. And the seat of the mind is the brain. Think of your brain as a spiritual antenna. And if your brain is sharp, if your brain is crisp, if your brain is healthy, then you can have a healthier spiritual experience. The devil knows this, which is precisely why he would love to have God's people addicted to all kinds of substances. Addicted to alcohol compromises the integrity of the brain. Addicted to cigarettes compromises the integrity of the brain. Addicted to drugs compromises the integrity of the brain. Addicted to pornography compromises the integrity of the brain. Addicted to food compromises the integrity of the brain. God wants us to be healthy in our brain so we can be healthy in our mind. God communicates with us through our mind, and thus we can be healthy in our spirit. In fact, notice here on the slide, a healthy body will result in a healthy mind. I want to say that again. A healthy body will result in a healthy mind. And as we've already seen, God is deeply concerned about our body because, as we've already said, our body is not our body. Jesus purchased our body on the cross of Calvary. That body doesn't belong to you. It belongs to God. You might think, well, it's my body. I can do whatever I want. No. Paul refutes that line of reasoning. Paul refutes that line of logic, as we've already seen in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. He says, you were bought with a price. You are not your own. That body is not your body. Imagine that I lent you my car and I say, hey, you can borrow my car, but there are certain stipulations. Because it's my car and you're borrowing it, I want you to put this kind of gas in it, and I want you to change the oil every so often, and I don't want you to go above this speed limit, and I want you to et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I could go right down the whole maintenance list, and you could say, well, it's my car, I'll drive it however I want, and I'll trash it how I want. And I say, no, that's not your car, that's my car. And because I'm the owner of the car, I have a right A what, everyone? A right to encourage you, yea, to command you to take care of my car in a way that coincides with my will and my desire, because the car belongs to me. Your body belongs to God. You need to disabuse your mind of this idea that, well, it's my body and I can live however I want. It's not your body. It's God's body. He purchased it. He purchased it, as we've already seen there in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. God wants us to have a healthy body so that we can have a healthy mind. And in having a healthy mind, it will significantly increase our chances of having a healthy spiritual relationship with God. Healthy body, healthy mind. It's also true that a healthy mind can also result in a healthy body. There's a reciprocal, mutual interface here between a healthy body and a healthy mind. There are what are called psychosomatic illnesses. A psychosomatic illness is an illness that is inflicted upon the body because the mind is unhealthy. In other words, someone thinks they're sick, and so the body responds in a sick way. In fact, I have this clever little thing that I do whenever I'm around people that are saying, I'm not feeling good. And they say, oh, really? I'm feeling great. I feel fantastic. In fact, I've never felt better. I just talk about how healthy I feel, how good I feel, et cetera, et cetera. And I believe that when I say those kinds of things, it actually does take place, that there are hormones and other things that take place in the mind that actually can bolster the immune system. This is actually what the book of Proverbs says, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Many people are sick for no greater reason than they think themselves to be so. Did you hear that? Many people are sick for no greater reason than they think themselves to be so. And so a healthy body helps to create a healthy mind, and a healthy mind in turn helps to create a healthy body. And so it's a very positive interrelationship here, a mutual relationship here, but it also can be switched around to be negative. Unhealthy body, unhealthy mind, unhealthy body. If this makes sense, everyone say amen. Amen. So God is concerned not just with our so-called spiritual lives, but very much He is concerned with our health and our physical lives as well. We're talking today about how to postpone your what? Funeral. What does it mean to glorify God? As we've already said, it means to live your life for God in every area of that fourfold dimensionality. Every area, whether physically, emotionally, spiritually, or socially, that's what it means to glorify God. Now look at this, Romans chapter 12, verse 1, the Apostle Paul. Now I'm actually reading here from the New King James Version. That's the version of the Bible that I prefer, but I really like the way that the New International Version translates this particular verse, and so I put it here on the screen for you. Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. Therefore, says Paul, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your, what is that word? Bodies as what? Living, what's that word? Sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. Now look at this. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do you see what he's saying there? He says the way that you take care of your body is a spiritual act of worship. Have you ever thought of that before? Notice that he says present your bodies as living sacrifices. That's a very interesting juxtaposition there with living and sacrifice together, because traditionally the way that we understand the word sacrifice is in terms of death, not in terms of life. Think of it this way. In the Old Testament, when something was sacrificed, that meant that it died. In the Old Testament, when a sacrifice was laid on the altar, that means that it had died. Even in our own modern language, if you're out, say, in the woods sometime with your friend and you come across a train track there, and you see the train is approaching and your friend is on the tracks, but for some reason he doesn't see the train approaching, if you push your friend off of those tracks and you also make it off of the tracks, you live and he lives, then the newspaper headline would not read, "Man sacrifices life to save friend." Because the idea of sacrifice has to do with death. But imagine that very same scenario. The train is approaching and there's only enough time for you to save either yourself, that is to just let your friend get hit, or you can push him off, but in the process of saving him, you are hit by the train. The newspaper headline could read, "Man sacrifices life to save friend." Sacrifice entails death. Sacrifice entails what, everyone? Death. That's why what Paul does here in Romans chapter 12 is so fascinating. He introduces not sacrifice and death, but sacrifice and life. Look at it again. Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as what? Living sacrifices. holy and pleasing to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. I tell you, I've heard so many people say, oh, if it comes down to the end time and the mark of the beast crisis, I'll be willing to die for God. If it comes right down to it and they say thus and so, and it comes between God serving him and death, I'll die for God. Beloved, surely, surely, surely God is happy that you are willing to die for him. But what God is looking for more in this day and age is not people who are willing to die for him, but people who are willing to live for him. Living sacrifices, a spiritual act of worship. You present your body to God. We think of prayer. Oh, prayer, that's a very spiritual time, and that God is interested in that. That's a spiritual act of worship. Nobody would deny that prayer is a spiritual act of worship. Nobody would deny that Bible study is a spiritual act of worship. But wait a minute, how you take care of your bodies is a spiritual act of worship? That's what the text says. This is agreeing perfectly with what we've seen in Romans and what we've seen in 1 Corinthians, is that the way that we take care of our bodies is not some little isolated thing. God's only concerned about the spirit. God's only concerned about the religious life. God is deeply and intimately concerned about how we take care of our bodies for a variety of reasons. Number one, it shows good stewardship. And number two, because a healthy body produces a healthy mind. A healthy mind is the seat of the intellect and the spiritual, moral, and emotional decisions. And God communicates with us through our mind. And so we don't have this little God who's sort of compartmentalized here, and whoo, we go to church on, you know, Sunday morning and Saturday morning or whatever day you happen to go to church. He says, oh, here I am. I'm a spiritual being now, and this is what God cares about. I sit in the pew for an hour or 2 hours, and oh, now I'm back out to my regular old self. Beloved, God does not want to be put into a little compartment, into a little box. Don't pigeonhole the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Don't pigeonhole the God of the Bible. God is concerned about you spiritually, yes. God is concerned about you physically as well. Now think of it this way. I have two children. Do you think I'm only concerned about the salvation of my children? Of course, I'm very concerned about that. But am I not also concerned about their physical health as well? Of course. It stands to reason. And so if you can eat to God's glory and you can drink to God's glory, and you can, we've already seen that, it must also be true that you can eat and drink in a way that is, guess what? Not to God's glory. And what I'd like to do from this point out is show you several practical instances. Several, what did I say, everyone? Practical instances as to how we can eat to the glory of God and cannot eat to the glory of God, and how we can drink to the glory of God and how we cannot drink to the glory of God. And you might be sitting there thinking to yourself, oh no, Pastor Ashrick, are you going to make a trip to my refrigerator? That's exactly what I'm saying. Notice here on the slide, it says, William Shakespeare, marvelous quotation from the play Othello, Act 2, Scene 3. He said, O God, that men should put an enemy in their mouths to steal away their what? Brains. That men would put an enemy in their mouth that steals away their brains. What do you think he's talking about? That's exactly right. He's talking about alcohol. I saw a t-shirt one time. Somebody was wearing a t-shirt that said, Instant idiot, just add alcohol. Beloved, when people are on alcohol, when people have consumed too much alcohol, they begin to lose control of their bodily functions because they've lost control of their cognitive functions. That's what Shakespeare's saying. Oh God, that men would put an enemy in the mouth that's palatable to the taste buds, but it destroys the mind. And I've had many people say to me, oh, well, the Bible teaches you can drink wine. Yeah, the Bible does teach you can drink wine. Unfermented wine. In fact, there are two kinds of wine in the Bible. There's unfermented wine and fermented wine. Unfermented and fermented, or the way I like to put it is, rotten and fresh. There's rotten wine and there's fresh wine in the Bible. Now someone's going to say, wait a minute, wine is wine. All wine is fermented. Let me ask you a question. I'm reading today from the New King James Version of the Bible, and as I read the New King James Version of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, I don't find one place where it uses the word grape juice. Grape juice. The word wine is used. Well, why? Because in the New and the Old Testaments, there was one word in the Old Testament, yayin. In the New Testament, there were several in the Old Testament, but primarily yayin. And in the New Testament, oinos. And that word can be rendered either as fermented or unfermented juice, depending on the context. Depending on the what, everyone? Context. And you remember how critical it is that we study the Bible in context, because if you don't, you could find yourself saying, roop, Judas hung himself. Well, that's not what I was looking for. Roop. go thou and do likewise. That's not what I was looking for. Roop, what thou doest, do quickly. That's certainly not what I was looking for. Beloved, we have to study the Bible in context. In what, everyone? Context. And so, if the Bible says that they drank wine and became drunk, clearly that's oinos, fermented. If the Bible says that they drank the new wine fresh from the vine, clearly that's non-fermented oinos. Okay? And someone says, really, are you saying that the Bible teaches that we shouldn't drink wine? That's exactly what anyone who uses it develops a serious drinking problem. 40%. Now, can you drink alcohol to the glory of God? I think the answer based on this simple statistic must be no. Imagine this. What if your dog bit 2 out of every 5 guests? What if your dog bit 2 out of every 5 people that came to your house? Would you keep the dog? Now, you're probably thinking to yourself, that depends. Do I get to pick the guests? That's not the point we're making here, beloved. The point we're making is this. If your dog bit 2 out of every 5 people that came to your house, you would call that dog dangerous. You would say that dog is not socially acceptable. I mean, there's no way. Let's take it a step further, though. What if your dog killed 2 out of every 5 people that came to your house? Because, beloved, many people that develop serious problems with alcohol end up dying of those very complications, whether it's through some terrible disease that's brought about, liver disease, or a child that's born with fetal alcohol syndrome, whatever it might be. Is God going to endorse something that brings about these kinds of horrific and terrible tragedies with such frequency? Good common sense and good logic tells you that that's absolutely impossible. In fact, I had 2 of my best friends in the world were killed by a drunk driver. Did you hear what I said? 2 of my best friends in the world were killed by a drunk driver, hit them going 125 miles an hour down the wrong side of the road. Bob and Bobby would still be alive today. Beloved, I want you to think about this. Surely, surely, surely the Bible has a great deal to say about the topic of alcohol, the issue of alcohol, but just good common sense will tell you. Good common sense will tell you that if 40% of people develop serious problems, that if things like spousal abuse, which many times are directly tied to alcohol and other things, and drunk drivers and fetal alcohol syndrome, I mean, all of these things, I mean, the Christian is going to look at that and say, oh, no problem, piece of cake, the Christian can do it. Beloved, listen. The Bible makes it clear that we should avoid these very things. In fact, open your Bibles to the book of Proverbs. Wisest man that ever lived, a man by the name of Solomon. I'm going to Proverbs chapter 20. Proverbs chapter 20. This becomes clear. The context makes it clear when you look at the difference between fermented and unfermented wine. Okay, that's the critical distinction. Fermented and unfermented. I'm in Proverbs chapter 20 and I'm noticing verse 1. Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 1. Wisest man who ever lived says, wine is a what? Mocker, and strong drink is raging. Whoever is led astray by it is not wise. Notice what he says. Wine will make fun of you. Wine will mock you. Wine will trash you and thrash you. He says it even more explicitly in Proverbs chapter 23. Notice this with me. Proverbs chapter 23, picking it up in verse 29. Proverbs chapter 23, picking it up in verse 29. Solomon begins with a series of rhetorical questions. He says, who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has contentions? Who has complaints? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who linger long at the wine, who go in search of mixed wine. Do not look on the wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it swirls around smoothly. At the last, it bites like a serpent, it stings like a viper. Your eyes will see strange things, your heart will utter perverse things. Yes, you will be like one who lies down in the midst of the sea, or like one who lies at the top of the mast, saying, they have struck me, but I was not hurt. They have beaten me, but I did not feel it. When shall I awake that I may seek another drink? I mean, Solomon here is describing the classic drunkard. Solomon here is describing the classic person who is wounds without cause and soreness of eyes and et cetera, et cetera. And he says he, you know, gets knocked out. He's like the person on the top of the mast. And when he finally wakes up, first thing out of his mouth, whoop, I need another one. Now, beloved, let's be clear about something. God loves alcoholics, but God hates alcoholism. And that's the point. 40% of people develop serious problems. Solomon says here, don't even look at it. And that doesn't mean drink it with your eyes closed. What it means is, don't even look at it. It's a temptation. And somebody says, well, Jesus made wine. Jesus made wine in John chapter 2 at the Feast of Cana. Jesus did make wine. He made oinos. But please, please, please don't try and convince me that Jesus Christ made gallons and gallons and gallons of fermented wine when Jesus himself came to save humanity. Isn't that what it says? Jesus came to save humanity. I'm looking in Luke chapter 19, verse 10. Luke chapter 19, verse 10, Jesus says, the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which is lost. And so we can summarize Jesus' mission as basically this. He came to save people. But yet the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 that drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. I want you to think about that for a moment. Drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. That is, unrepentant drunkards who don't get the victory will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. But wait a minute. 40% of people who drink alcohol develop a serious problem. 40% of people who drink alcohol become drunkards. So you're going to tell me that Jesus, the one who came to save, Jesus, the one who came to redeem, Jesus, the one who came to rescue us from sin, is actually contributing at a party with hundreds, perhaps gallons and gallons and gallons of alcohol for the purpose of keeping everybody happy, knowing that many of the people that would have drank that very wine that Jesus made would have gone on to have serious problems and would have become drunkards? Knowing that that would contribute to their non-salvation, to their loss of salvation, to their eternal damnation? Beloved, this is not the Jesus of the Bible. In fact, when Jesus held up that wine, you want to find there with me in Mark chapter 13. See if you can go there with me, second book of the New Testament, Mark chapter 13. When Jesus here blesses the wine, when Jesus here, let's see if we can find it here, John chapter 14, Mark chapter 13. Let's see if we can find it here. Render unto Caesar, beware of the scribes, Mark 13. We're going to find it here any second now. Here we are. John chapter 14. Jesus here is celebrating the Passover, the Last Supper, with his disciples. And he says something very interesting in verse 22. I'm in Mark chapter 14 and verse 22. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and eat. This is my body. Verse 23, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and they all drank from it. Now look at verse 24. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. So that wine represented the blood of Jesus. Verse 25, assuredly I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until the day that I drink it new with you in the kingdom of God. Three things in this chapter, in this passage, indicate very clearly that the wine that Jesus offered up as the wine of the covenant was not fermented wine. Number one, it represented his blood. Fermentation to the Jews, like leaven to the Jews, was a sign of sin. A sign of what, everyone? Sin. And so can you imagine Jesus holding up this thing and saying, this is my blood, this sin-stained, sin-defiled blood is my blood of the new covenant? It would have made no sense, number one. Number two, he says, I won't drink of the fruit of the vine. The fruit of the vine. You see, think of it this way. There are two kinds of wine. There's the fresh juice that comes fresh from the cluster, and then there's the fermented. That is, remember, the fresh and the rotten. Jesus uses the terminology fruit of the vine. You know he's talking about the juice that came fresh from the fruit, fresh from the cluster, fresh from the vine. That's not fermented. It takes time for things to ferment. That's why they say, oh, this is a very good year, 1974. Perfect. Beloved, this would have been fresh. Not aging and aging and aging and fermenting. And then he says, number three, until the day I drink it new with you in the kingdom of heaven. This was new wine, not the old wine. Jesus was crucified around the Passover. Passover is in spring. This would have been the time of harvest. Beloved, Jesus would not have offered fermented alcoholic wine to people at the wedding of Cana for one reason, for several reasons. First of all, the Old Testament prohibits it, as we've already seen in Proverbs. Other texts could be cited. And number two, because Jesus came to save men, not to contribute to their eternal damnation. If you believe that, say amen. But the second point here is Jesus would not have offered, no way would he have offered up fermented wine as a sign of his blood of the new covenant. Makes no sense. Beloved, I'm going to go so far as to say that even if the Bible said nothing about wine, even if the Bible was totally silent on it, any Christian who has his or her head screwed on straight can look at the effects of alcohol, can look at the, what did I say, everyone? Effects of alcohol and say it cannot be consumed and imbibed to the glory of God. Impossible. It's like oil and water. And someone says, well, I'm a social drinker. I drink just a little bit. Beloved, nobody starts drinking thinking to themselves, I think I'll become a drunkard. I think I'll become totally sloshed and ruin my family and ruin my marriage. No one starts drinking that way. Everyone starts as a social drinker. So I would say, as plain as the noonday sun, you cannot drink alcohol to the glory of God. Impossible. That's a biblical conviction, and frankly, it's just a plain logical conviction. Before I became a Christian, I took care of people that had developmental disabilities, people with Down syndrome, people with autism, and I took care of a young man by the name of Joshua Martinez. He had fetal alcohol syndrome, and oh, it was so dear to me. He was approximately my age, and I loved him so much, but his mind was so impaired. He couldn't speak. He couldn't talk. In fact, all he could do was say, and he would take his hand, his little palsied hand, and he would hold it up to his thing, and he'd say, "Oh, mama." He would push his mandible up into his mouth to make him say, "Mama, mama, mama." And I wanted, Josh, of course, could never understand it, but he missed his mom, and he loved his mom, and he was living in this home. And the whole time, I remember looking at that situation with total frustration, total consternation, because here he longed for his mom, he loved his mom, he missed his mom, and yet it was his mom who put him in that situation. Don't tell me Jesus is like that. Don't tell me that Jesus is going to contribute to people's condemnation, contribute to people's damnation, contribute to people's loss of salvation by making gallons and gallons and gallons of fermented wine, knowing that somebody's going to get, "Hey, how you doing?" Start hitting on other people's wives and committing adultery or hitting on someone's husband. No! There are two kinds of wines in the Bible, fermented and unfermented. And sure, you want to have a nice fresh glass of Welch's grape juice? Amen. I'm the same way. In fact, I can hardly even eat a meal without having a little grape juice at the end of it. But I'll tell you what, I don't want the rotten stuff, I want the fresh stuff. If you believe that, say amen. Amen. Now, it's not just alcohol, beloved. There are other lifestyle practices that contribute to the shortening and other lifestyle practices that harm our bodies. Dr. Linus Pauling said that every cigarette you smoke takes 14.5 minutes off of your life. And someone says, "Wait a minute, are you going to say that the Bible condemns smoking? Show me a verse that says you can't smoke." Beloved, I can't show you a verse that says thou shalt not smoke. But I can't show you a verse that says thou shalt not smoke crack cocaine either. I can't show you a verse that says you shouldn't shoot heroin. It's common sense. God has given you a mind. Now use it. Someone say amen. If these things are taking 14.5 minutes off of your life, every single cigarette, how could you possibly do that to the glory of God, who is himself the life giver? God gives life, Satan takes life, and anything that prematurely, unnecessarily, as an addiction, takes your life away is not from God. I want to underscore here something very important, by the way. God loves cigarette smokers. Somebody say amen. But God hates cigarettes. And that's the point. See, we love the sin and hate the sinner, but God loves the sinner and hates the sin. Look at this. Nicotine ends in I-N-E. Cocaine ends in I-N-E. Heroin ends in I-N. Strychnine ends in I-N-E. And caffeine in I-N-E. All of these drugs are of the same subnarcotic class. And you look at that last one and you think, "Wait a minute. Is he actually saying caffeine?" I am saying caffeine. Beloved, caffeine is a very strong stimulant. You cannot consume caffeine without being unaffected by its stimulant properties. I look at this whole Starbucks craze and this whole coffee craze, and I think to myself, no. Caffeine is a drug. Now, are you saying, David, that everyone who drinks coffee is not a Christian? No, I didn't say that. What I am saying is, I don't think we're going to be going to the heavenly coffee shops in the New Jerusalem. That's what I'm saying. Listen, if you can't shoot heroin to the glory of God, and if you can't take cocaine to the glory of God, and if you can't take strychnine to the glory of God, then why, pray tell, should you be able to take caffeine to the glory of God? I mean, just answer me. That's a very logical question. Beloved, God has given us bodies. He's given us what? Bodies, and he wants us to take care of those bodies. Several years ago, I read this book entitled Caffeine Blues by Stephen Chernisky. He says, wake up to the hidden dangers of America's number one drugs. One of the most powerful things in there is they interviewed a representative from the FDA, and he asked him straight out. He said, listen, if caffeine came up today as a to be passed for general consumption, so my little five-year-old boy can go into the supermarket and buy a Red Bull. My friend's little seven-year-old boy can go into the supermarket and buy one of these, you know, caffeine-laden drinks. He asked them a question. Would it pass approval by the FDA for general consumption? And the FDA representative said, no way. Too many health risks, too many problems for general consumption, no way. And he even suggested it might not have been approved for consumption at all. In fact, I highly recommend that book. Don't just think, well, everybody's doing it. I mean, everybody likes to drink a little coffee. Listen, beloved, maybe you do need the coffee, but think about it. You need it. Let that sink into your mind. You need it. If you're sitting there today thinking, well, I need that morning cup of coffee, think about what you're saying. If you need it, you're addicted to it. Now, I don't want to be so strong here, and I don't want you to think that I'm unreasonable or irrational. I just want us to be thinking about how we can be living to the glory of who, everyone? To the glory of God, and that's the point. I used to be totally addicted to caffeine. I used to drink so much caffeine that I've probably done irreparable damage to my gastrointestinal system. But beloved, when I stopped drinking caffeine, I got headaches, I got the shakes, I got the shivers, I was cold, it lasted for almost a week. Why? Because it's a drug. It's a drug. God has given you water, drink water. Does God have anything to say about the things we eat? It's not just smoking and it's not just alcohol. The answer is yes. God did give us things to eat. And there are many things that He wants us to eat, fresh fruits and vegetables and those things that He has created to be eaten. But there are some things that many people eat today that are not created to be eaten. There are certain things that people are eating in this fast food, convenience-driven society, and obesity is off the charts, and lifestyle-related diseases are off the charts. I mean, it's absolutely incredible that the majority of diseases that people die of today are diseases that they are inflicting on themselves. Before I became a Christian, I was studying medicine at the University of Wyoming, and my senior professor told me, David, listen to me, if people stopped drinking, that is alcohol, if people stopped smoking cigarettes, and if people started eating right and getting a little exercise and drinking enough water, he said this to me, he wasn't even a Christian person at all, he said 90% of doctors would be out of business in the first 10 years. Now think about that. What that tells me is that it's our lifestyle-related practices that are contributing to our ill health, that are contributing to the national health care epidemic problems that we're in this culture and in other cultures. What we put into our minds is destroying our body. God instructed Noah to bring both clean and unclean animals onto the ark. You can read all about it in Genesis chapter 7. He said, bring seven of the clean, but only two of the unclean. Well, why seven of the clean? Because after the flood, meat could be eaten. After the what did I say, everyone? After the flood, meat could be eaten and not before. When God created Adam and Eve, He put them in the garden and they were fruitarians. Now you might have never heard that term before. Fruitarians? Yeah, that's right. They ate fruit. They ate fruit. But then after the flood, they began to eat meat. They began to eat what, everyone? Meat. And if you look at this slide here, you actually see this is a chart. This doesn't represent their heights. This represents their relative ages. And so you have here Noah holding the boat and people before him. I mean, think of it. Adam lived 930 years, and Methuselah lived 969, and Jared lived 962. And then you go after the flood when people started eating meat. Of course, there were a variety of factors, but this would have been one of the most significant. The ages of the patriarchs, Shem, Ham, Japheth, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, woo, and today we're happy if we make it to 70. 80 if you're lucky. Beloved, God has given us permission to eat meat. There's no question about that. But God knows that the eating of meat will eventually harm the fine-tuned internal systems of the body, especially if you eat an inordinate amount of meat. But even then, the meat that we eat has to be clean. Has to be what, everyone? Clean. Now, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here. You can look this up in Leviticus chapter 11 for yourself. In Leviticus chapter 11, it says, if you're going to eat an animal, it has to have two things. It has to have a cloven hoof, and it has to chew the cud. Two things. It has to chew the cud like a cow chews the cud, and it has to have a split hoof. Okay? And he gives a list of all the things there, of course, that you could eat. I mean, it would say things like a cow, of course, split hoof and cloven, choose the cud, no problem. A deer, no problem. An elk, no problem. But what about a horse? Could you eat a horse? No, because even if they chew the cud, they don't split the hoof. What about a pig? Could you eat a pig? The answer is no, because even though they split the hoof, they don't chew the cud. And so God says, if you want to eat meat, hey, that's up to you. That's your business. I happen to be a vegetarian. Now, I'm not saying that you have to become a vegetarian. I'm not suggesting that at all. But what I am saying is this. The vegetarian lifestyle is consistently medically demonstrated to be the healthiest lifestyle for people who eat a well-balanced diet of fruits and vegetables and nuts and grains, etc. Okay? I happen to be a vegetarian because there's just too much junk going into the meat nowadays. Too many hormones, too much nastiness, unclean slaughterhouses, and every other kind of thing. I'm just not going to risk it. I'm personally not going to risk it. But if you want to risk it, hey, that's up to you. But the point here is this. While eating meat is not a sin, be sure that you're eating clean meats. What kind of meats, everyone? Clean meats. And someone says, oh, well, that's only for the Jews. That's not only for the Jews. Was Noah a Jew? Noah wasn't a Jew. Noah came before the first Jew, Abraham, by several hundred years, perhaps even as much as 1,000 years. So think about that. If God instructed Noah, there's a distinction between clean and unclean, it must mean that those distinctions existed before the time of the Jews. Before the time of the Jews. Pork is an unclean meat. It has the highest fat content of all meats, and it is not to be eaten if you're going to follow what the Bible has to say. You can talk about trick nine, and we're not going to go into that. Let's go to seafood. Very simple. If you want to eat something that comes out of the water, it just has to have two things. Just like the animal, has to have a cloven foot and chew the cud. If something's going to come out of the water, it has to have fins and scales. Fins and what, everyone? Fins and scales. And so lobster, no fins, no scales, it's out. Shrimp, it's out. Oysters, it's out. Salmon, would that be in or out? That would be in, that's right, because it has fins and scales. By the way, you wouldn't want to eat those things anyway when you really discovered what they were all about. Dr. Bruce Halstead did some research for the Navy, and he basically said, listen, sailors, when you get shot down and you're in the, you know, on an island, or you're trying to make do with eating some fish out of the sea, he produced this huge manual, and finally they said, hey, listen, we can't expect our sailors to read this whole manual. How can they know in a more simplistic way? And he said, simple. If it has fins and scales, it's safe to eat. If it doesn't, don't eat it. Very simple. He confirmed the Bible's findings. Shellfish are dirty and dangerous, said Prevention Magazine. Shellfish are dirty and dangerous. These things are filter feeders. The reason they call them filter feeders is they filter all the impurities that the other animals in the sea are getting rid of. God created certain things to be eaten and other things not to be eaten. If God has created something to be eaten, you can eat it. God has given permission to eat clean foods, but think even of the children of Israel in the wilderness. God had given them manna. The Bible says that manna was like the coriander seed with a little honey. It was a vegetarian thing, but they said, oh, we miss all the good stuff back in Egypt, the leeks and the onions and the meat. And God said, okay, listen, you really want meat? And he sent them quail. He sent them what, everyone? He sent them quail. But notice what happens. They began to eat that quail, and many of them died when the quail was still in their mouth. God had given them permission. He'd given them what, everyone? Permission. So there are things that you can do that may or may not be in your best interest as far as your physical body goes. I want to be clear what I'm saying here, what I'm not saying. If you want to eat meat, that's fine. If you want to eat meat, that's up to you. That's a choice you're making. Now, I believe that if you're going to eat meat, you also need to be eating a well-balanced diet. Any nutritionist would tell you that. You need lots of fiber, you need lots of fruits, you need lots of vegetables and grains. But as far as the unclean meats go, whether you're talking about pig or anything that does not split the hoof or chew the cud, no. No, because God says it's an abomination to him. You can read about it in Leviticus chapter 11. Someone says, what about the birds? In Leviticus chapter 11, it basically just gives a list of the birds you can't eat, and it's pretty simple. You don't eat things like vultures and hawks and kites and kestrels and falcons and owls. The birds that are chicken-like birds, what are sometimes referred to as gallinaceous birds, those birds you can eat. That would be like the grouse or the turkey or the chicken, etc. Okay? Exodus chapter 15, we're going to skip over that. Let's just make a little haste here. Let's get right down to the end. Okay, here we go. And still a little more, finally, and one more slide. Philippians chapter 3, verse 19, the Apostle Paul says, speaking of those people who put their own satisfaction, their own desires, and their own taste buds above God's will, he said, whose end is destruction, notice this, whose God is in their what? Whose God is in their belly, and whose glory is in their shame, who set their mind on earthly things. Now, some of this might come as a little bit of a surprise to some of you. You're thinking, wait a minute, are you kidding me? I mean, does the Bible really say that there are certain things that we can eat and certain things that we can't eat? That's exactly what the Bible says. Now, it's not because God doesn't love you. In fact, God does love you. As we've already seen, God loves us tremendously. He gave His Son to save us. He gave His Son who died for us and purchased us on the cross of Calvary. As Paul says, you are not your own, you're bought with a price. So God wants us to take care of the body that He has entrusted to us. A healthy body results in a healthy mind. A healthy mind makes a healthy spiritual experience more likely. And so, beloved, as we wrap this up, we've seen that God is interested in our physical health, as well as our spiritual health, as well as our social health, as well as our intellectual health. And all of these things are related to one another in a symbiotic kind of relationship. And surely God, as a good parent, is going to have concerns about certain things that you would eat or wouldn't eat. I mean, I wouldn't let my son eat 4 pieces of chocolate cake. Why? Because I hate him? No, because I love him. One day when I was a boy, I'd gotten under the kitchen sink and I was about ready to eat some Ajax, and my mom came up and slapped the Ajax out of my hand. Why did she slap it out of my hand? Because she hated me or because she loved me? Because she loved me, beloved. When God tells us to avoid certain things, when God tells us not to eat certain things, it's not because he hates us, it's because he loves us. And I want to quickly address this last objection. Someone says, well, that's just for the Jews. Beloved, we've already looked at that when it comes to the clean and unclean, because Noah had the distinction between the clean and the unclean. But let me ask you this question. Did Jesus die on the cross to cleanse pigs or to cleanse men? Jesus didn't die on the cross to cleanse a pig. He didn't die on the cross to cleanse a pig to make a pig clean. Jesus died on the cross to make men clean. Can you say amen to that? Absolutely. And so, beloved, we close with this quotation that we opened with. Beloved, I pray that you may prosper in all things and be in health, just as your soul prospers. National Geographic ran an article, fascinating article, in which they looked at the three healthiest population groups in the world in terms of longevity. The Okinawans, which is an isolated geographical group, the Sardinians, which is an isolated geographical group, and this strange group of people called the Seventh-day Adventists. These are the three healthiest groups of people in the world. Now, beloved, I want you to think about that. That group there, the Seventh-day Adventists, there have been government-sanctioned studies that have, in fact, there's one going on right now, that has looked into why these people are healthier than the surrounding population. You want to know what the answer is? So simple. Because they follow the Bible's guidelines for optimum physical, mental, moral, and spiritual health. The average Seventh-day Adventist lives 7 to 10 years longer than another person in the population. Why? Because God loves them more? Not at all. Because they're living by the Bible's prescription for optimum physical health. Now, I'm not saying to you right now, oh, you have to become a Seventh-day Adventist so you can live longer. What I'm saying is follow the Bible, whatever church you go to, wherever denomination you're in. Follow the Bible and the Bible only. God will lead you. God will guide you. He wants you to be physically healthy. He wants you to be spiritually healthy. He wants you to be emotionally healthy. He wants you to be mentally healthy. Someone say, amen. Someone says, David, are you a Seventh-day Adventist? Yes, I am a Seventh-day Adventist. Why? Because they follow the Bible most closely and because everything they teach comes from a plain thus saith the Lord. That's why I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. Do I also follow the Bible's prescription for health? Yes, I do. And I would invite every one of you to seriously consider doing the very same thing. How many of you say, if it's in the Bible, I want to believe it. I want to live by what's in the Bible. Amen. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we do want to live by what's in this word. We do want to live by what's between these pages. Even if sometimes it cuts across us, even if sometimes it's new to us. Father, we want to live by these great truths. Whether it has to do with our physical health or our spiritual health, whatever it might be, Father, if it's in your word, we believe it. We want to live by it. We want to love it. Help us, O God, in areas where we're weak, make us strong. Where we're broken, heal us. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Let everyone say, amen.